Great to be with you today, as always, as we travel down the road to integrity. I'm excited about this new series. We are in a book of the Bible called James, in the New Testament portion of our Bibles. And James is the half-brother of Jesus. He goes on to be the pastor of the church in Jerusalem in that first century. And so just lots of great stuff packed into this book. This book, I love it because it just challenges you. It gives you this like spiritual gut punch, if you will. Are you living your life, you know, the way God intended? Are you walking your talk? All those sorts of things. Are you living in integrity? That's kind of the bottom line of it all. For instance, we might say that our kids are our priority, but if we have little patience or time for them, then there's a lack of integrity there. What we say and what we're doing are two different things. If we say we're fully devoted followers of Jesus, and we do little to cultivate our faith, then there's an integrity issue. What we're saying and what we're doing aren't in alignment. Maybe you're a parent and you say that my top priority is I want to raise my kids in a Christian home and in the Christian faith and all of that. But then, everything else in life takes priority over that, whether it's sports or hobbies or whatever. You never be able to get to church. Then there's an integrity issue with what you're saying and what you're actually doing. I think you're getting the idea, right? You say you want to live on a budget, but there's endless Amazon packages on your doorstep, then you might not be living in that budget. Just possible, unless you have a huge budget, which would be awesome if you had that. But anyway, these are all just examples of, and there's endless examples of that demonstrate, how easy it is to live with a lack of integrity in our lives. And so together, we've committed this summer to get on this road to integrity and see if God can't make some great improvements in our lives. I know He can. Integrity is defined as being honest. And, having strong moral principles, moral uprightness, all fueled by God's word and what God says is right. It speaks of complete. It speaks of whole. It speaks of undivided. It speaks of one and the same. In other words, you're not one person here and then another person there. Who you are in private is who you are in public. All those good things. It speaks of being one and the same, no matter if there's good things happening in your life or maybe negative things happening in your life. Jesus, of course, is our highest example of integrity. When you look at Jesus, there is a picture of perfect integrity. And the Holy Spirit wants to help us to reflect Him so that others can come to know His love and the gift of eternal life that maybe you and I enjoy. So here's the good news. Here's the good news. You may not be walking in perfect integrity and all of that right now, but we can all become people of integrity. We can all be people of integrity with God's help in our lives. So let's get started with reading. If you have God's word, go ahead and hold it up and repeat after me. I love God's word. It feeds me. It guides me. It directs me. And I want to add one more. It protects me. Yeah, God's word protects us from a lot of stuff. All right, James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. We read this last week, but we're going to drill down even deeper here today. So James 1, starting with verse 2. Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. All right. Yeah, so let's look at this. I don't think any of us want to hear that our troubles are an opportunity for joy. How many want to hear that? Not so much, right? I don't want to hear that my troubles are an opportunity for joy. We really don't want to hear that, you know, that our lives are going to be challenging or AKA troubling, so that we can grow in endurance. In fact, I don't think we even want to admit that we will experience troubles, you know, testings, difficulties, challenges. We're kind of like, knock on wood. I don't want that to happen in my life, you know, even mention it. Knock on wood. We don't want that to happen. And yet God's word is very clear. It's so clear when it says, when troubles of any kind come your way. What is James saying there? James is trying to prepare and equip us for what is inevitable. What is inevitable in life, right? Challenges, in other words, they're going to happen. There's no escaping them. Yeah. And so you need to be prepared so that good stuff comes out of it, is basically what he's saying. For instance, when you're planning a hike, I love to hike, or maybe a backpacking trip, you know, what do you do? I mean, before you go, you prepare, you equip yourself for the challenges that you might face, right? And the ones you will. You don't expect the terrain to be perfectly flat and paved. It wouldn't be a very good hike, would it? You expect that there's going to be some variation. There's going to be some going downhill, and there's going to be some going uphill. There's going to be some obstacles. There's going to be some, you know, stumbling points. It's going to get rough. It's going to get muddy, possibly. All that stuff. I mean, you're probably going to face some weather challenges. You will in the Pacific Northwest for sure, right? It might get hot. It might get cold. It might get windy. It might be dry. It might be wet. It might be all of the above. But you go into the trip knowing that. So you prepare. You equip yourself so that you will have a successful hiking trip, backpacking trip, no matter what. But, and what's cool about that is you can face all the challenges on the way because you're prepared for them, right? You can take them on, right? You can conquer that. And in the end, you're probably going to grow as a result. You say, that was amazing. I can't believe I did that. And you can look back at the experience with joy. Yeah, with joy. That was amazing, right? With joy. You know, my study notes in one of my study Bibles, anyway, says this about this particular section of Scripture. It says, the proper attitude in meeting adversity is to count it all joy, which is not an emotional reaction, but a deliberate, intelligent appraisal of the situation from God's perspective. We have been talking about that. Looking at things from God's perspective is so important. Getting his wisdom, right? Viewing trials as a means of moral and spiritual growth. We do not rejoice in the trials themselves. No, that's insanity, right? But in their possible results. That's what we rejoice in. It's the difference between thinking of yourself as a victim or a victor. That's the way I want to live my life, a victor in Jesus. It's intentionally looking at challenges, again, from God's point of view rather than our own point of view, because we have all these blind spots. We can't see everything. It's trusting that God has your best interest at heart, and really trusting him that he's going to use these troubles to accomplish, you know, not bad things, but good things in your life. Really believing that in faith. Yes, we know troubles and challenges aren't pleasant. They're not pleasant to me, right? But as Jesus people, we know that God is for us. He's not against us. Amen. Therefore, we trust that God is working for our good. He, even in this, you know, tough situation, he's working for our good. We can walk through the trouble then with integrity. Integrity. So let's learn more about what positive things God can and will do through the challenges that you and I face. Are you ready? Here we go. First, Challenges are an opportunity for evaluation. Say that. Challenges are an opportunity for evaluation. Verse 3 says, "For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow." Yeah, tough times and situations like that serve as opportunities to appraise, how are we doing with our faith in Jesus? It's an opportunity to assess, right? Where are we, you know, with our faith when it gets tough type of thing? It's an opportunity to consider whether we really trust God or not, whether we need to have some growing to do. If not, we need to do some growing, right? Trust is something that we put our confidence in, you know, something that we know will hold us. Do you believe God will hold you no matter what? I mentioned last week that everyone exercised faith when they came into the room or they sat in the, you guys out there, they sat in your chair, right? You had faith that it would hold you, that it would hold you up, right? Well, we need to have faith like that, that believing that God's going to hold us no matter what. No matter what we're facing. You see, test here speaks of proving what's genuine. Proving what's genuine. Trials, troubles, challenges have the ability to reveal whether our faith in Jesus is genuine or not. And if not, God is good. He's going to help us grow so that it becomes a genuine faith if we're teachable. Challenges, they test the quality of our faith. They test the value of our faith. Do we really value it? Challenges test the usefulness of our faith. You know what I mean? Challenges, they give us opportunity to prove the authenticity of our relationship with Jesus. Is it authentic? Yeah. Picture a refiner's fire here, because that's really what James is talking about here, or a forge, you know, a forge where they make metal objects like knives or swords or all kinds of different stuff, right, where they want to temper metal. James is referring to the qualities of character and righteousness that are forged in the furnace of affliction. There's some things that can only be forged by going through stuff. That's what he's talking about. In fact, Peter talks about it in 1 Peter 1:7. He says it this way. These trials, he's writing to people going through trials, these trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. So this is even an eschatological point of view, that in the end, you know, our faith is going to be proven genuine, right? So though the trial itself is painful, I don't mean it's not painful. It can be really painful and it can be unpleasant. What it produces is eternally glorious. That's the picture here. Lamentations 3:40, I think speaks to this really well. It says, "Instead, let us test and examine our ways. Let us turn back to the Lord." So we go through stuff. It reveals where we need work, where God still needs to work, where we need to yield and surrender and all of that. Challenges give us the opportunity to test and examine our ways and adjust. We want to make adjustments, and that builds character. That builds integrity. In other words, that which is genuine will survive the refining process. Everything else won't, but that which is eternal, that which God really wants in our lives, that will survive. When we face tough things, do we rely on ourselves, or do we rely on Jesus? When we experience difficulty, do we blame God, or do we trust God? When life's hard, it can be so hard, right? Do we focus on ourselves as victims or victors in Jesus, because we know him, right? So challenges are an opportunity for evaluation. But there's more. There's more. It sounds like a Ginsu knife commercial, but there's more. Anyway, there's more. Challenges give us the opportunity also to grow in our faith, to become more like Jesus. Have you ever done, strength training of some kind in your life? If you have, you'll get this illustration maybe better than others, because strength training is all about what? Resistance. If that's what challenges do, it brings resistance to our faith. Lifting weights builds muscle through that resistance. It does this through a biological process called muscle hypertrophy. Hypertrophy. I can never say that word. But anyway, I gave it a good shot. It's the body's way of repairing damaged muscle tissue after exercise. It's this refusing of the fibers after intensive resistance. When you lift weights, your muscles, in essence, they get torn down in a good way. They get torn down. That's why you're sore afterwards. And then the body repairs it. Okay, that's the process. And that causes your muscles to grow stronger and stronger every time you subject them to that process of resistance. Well, life throws resistance at us, at our faith, and we can grow. James says in 1:3, "For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow." It speaks of course, personal and spiritual growth, growing in one's faith in Jesus. When we first come to Jesus, what are we? We're spiritual infants, we're babies. We can only really handle the milk of God's word, you know, kind of the simple stuff. We're not really super challenged. It's all good and happy. But then as you have to grow. And so God's going to give you more and more of his word, more and more meat, and then he's going to challenge you. And as he challenges you, you're going to run into resistance. And then if you do it from God's perspective, from his wisdom, you're going to start growing stronger and stronger in your newfound faith in Jesus. And as we look at those situations from God's perspective, we become more and more prepared and equipped to take on even greater challenges. And though it can be uncomfortable, oh man, it can be uncomfortable and even painful, each time we become, stronger in Jesus, constantly stronger in Jesus. Endurance speaks of strength, fortitude, stamina, durability. God wants believers like that, okay? Like what's needed for a runner to finish a long distance race. You know, Paul uses oftentimes those athletic competitions, the Olympia type competitions of ancient Greece that he knows about, he sees firsthand. He uses those as illustrations, and he uses a runner quite often. But this race, this runner isn't running a sprint. No, it's not a short race. I mean, life is a marathon, right? And maybe in some ways it's a long distance relay race, even better said. Someone shares their faith in Jesus with you. So in essence, they pass the baton onto you. And then what do? They run with you. They run with you until you're ready to take it on your own. And then as we grow and we become stronger and stronger, right? We pass that baton. We invite others into the race and we pass that baton to them. And then we run with them and eventually they let go of it. So challenges give us the opportunity to grow, right? If we will look at them again from God's point of view, from his perspective. And finally, challenges give us the opportunity to become complete. What does that mean? To become complete. Well, integrity speaks of completeness, wholeness, one and the same. What we say is what we do. We're the same whether we're at work or whether we're at church or we're, you get the idea, right? James 1:4, so let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, so there's a process, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing, it says. So in these verses, we see really clearly the progression of growing in your faith and discipleship, right? We evaluate, we grow in endurance, and eventually it says we're made complete. God makes us complete. Remember that refiner's fire, that forge imagery I talked about earlier? Well, here's what's something really interesting. I want you to just think about this a minute, chew on it. Well-tempered metal is more precious than the raw material that it's made from. Well-tempered metal is more precious than the raw material that it's made from. What is that? Well, the characteristics of a metal, especially steel, has been improved dramatically through the tempering process, through the heating and cooling and the heating and cooling, all of that. It's been hardened. It's like a knife, like if they're making a knife or a sword or whatever. It's been made tougher, right? So that it won't break. God doesn't want us to break. God wants us to be tougher, in our faith. Now, it can be, now, when that happens, that process happens, now it can be much more effective, right? It can be more useful. It's complete. It doesn't matter the situation. It's just one and the same. The same is true for the Christian. When we're willing to see troubles and challenges, again, from God's perspective, through his wisdom, with patience and endurance to go through it, it's not easy. God will use the process to make us complete or whole, more useful, more effective in his mighty hands. We are ready to live out actions of moral integrity, right? Through, like, we're kind of like become battle-hardened spiritual soldiers, if you will. Not only do we rejoice with those who rejoice, it's not hard to rejoice with those that rejoice. Now we're able to weep with those that weep. Now that's more difficult. Okay, how can we learn to forgive, right? Unless we've been sinned against, unless we've been hurt. So we go through that, right? Our faith is tested. How can we develop self-control unless maybe we've failed or we've gotten really frustrated or we've been angered, right? And we're up against it. We're up against it. Nobody likes troubles and trials and challenges, as I've been saying. But the bottom line is we are made stronger Christians through them, by them. And we can take what? Great joy in that. Yeah, in that. Romans 8:28 tells us, and we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. There it is. God's plan for this world was, of course, perfection, and he created the world, he created people, and it was good, and it was beautiful, right? And humanity walked in this loving relationship with God, Adam and Eve, the Garden of Eden, and all of that. It was paradise, but then Adam and Eve are tempted by the evil one, and they cave to that, and they reject God, and they go into rebellion, and it changes everything. That's why humanity's rejection of God in the Garden of Eden is referred to as what? The fall, right? There's this fall that happens. No longer would we walk in the close relationship with God that he created us to walk in because he's holy, he's perfect, and then we're sinful. So there's this big divide, and we're unable to live out God's perfect ways. We fall short of his standards, and that's called sin. The wages of sin is death. Sin separates us from God, and we live with the consequences of that. You and I live with the consequences of that every day. The pain, the sickness, the difficulties, the unfairness, lack of justice. Those are all a result of sin. It's not part of God's plan. That's a result of sin. Those things are a work of Satan, the devil, who goes about as a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour, wanting to steal and kill and destroy. That's what he wants for your life. His whole goal is to keep us from loving our Creator and being complete. But Jesus came to restore us. He came to restore us. That's the good news. The good news is Jesus. Yeah. who loved us so much that he came and died for our sin and conquered that sin and offers us eternal life. What does John 3:16 say? For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. You can have eternal life today by putting your faith in Jesus. Jesus came to earth. He took your sin, my sin upon himself, and he paid its price with his life, with death, right? And the wages of sin again is death. Why? So that we can live in loving relationship with our Creator once again, that we can be people of integrity. Yeah, we're not controlled by all this stuff. We're controlled by our faith in God. Yeah, God does not like smite believers with troubles and challenges to be, you know, punish us and be spiteful. No. He uses them for his purposes to perfect us, to restore us, to make us whole, to bring within us integrity again, to make us people that are strong and effective, ready to be used of him. You know, Jesus made it very clear that we would experience trouble because we live in a sinful world. And what does he do? He gives us, what does James do? He gives us a heads up, right? A warning sign, if you will. He does because God, again, God loves us so much. He doesn't want us, you know, to go over the cliff, right, type of thing. He warns us of the dangers ahead so that we can be prepared and become stronger and stronger in our faith. I mean, Jesus said in John 16:33, I've told you all this. You know, he's going away. He's going to die. He's going to go away. So that you may have peace in me. Where's our peace? It's in him, the Prince of Peace. Here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows. You're going to have them. But take heart because I've overcome the world. When you're driving and you see a yellow caution sign, what do you do? What do you do? Well, if you're smart, you take precautions, right? You take the necessary steps. You put both hands on the wheel. You're a little more attentive. You take your foot off the gas. You slow down a little bit. You're prepared now. There might be rough road ahead or a bump or a hairpin turn or whatever it is. We don't like blame the sign, that stupid sign, you know, all that kind of stuff. We recognize that there's road work in progress and we need to be patient and we need to prepare, right? Well, the same is true in our spiritual journeys. God cautions us in life, you know, that basically this is a work in progress, right? Our lives are a work in progress. So expect troubles, expect challenges. Rough road is ahead. But unlike those who don't believe, they don't believe in Jesus, they don't believe in God, the challenges we face when we look at them from God's perspective will actually accomplish good things in our lives if we will embrace them in Jesus. You know, we have a lot of needs. We all do. We face lots of challenges, every single one of us. Sickness, strained relationships, broken families, addictions, work issues, you know, life challenges of every kind, even death, you know. Man, we have a lot of people in our church facing some real challenges right now, so we need to pray for one another to be strong. We are hurting people because why? We live in a world broken, twisted by sin. So sadly, we experience all that stuff. But James believes and even assumes, here's James' perspective, that the believer will pass the test. Yeah, you're going to go through all this stuff, but it's going to produce great things in you. Take joy in it. Yeah, we can face those things with joy knowing that we will grow and we're going to become more complete and whole in Jesus. Well, we're going to take some time to pray today, to just talk with God. And I want to invite you to join me in this prayer and really let it come from your heart. If God's talking to you and you want to take meaningful steps today, would you join me in a special prayer? Let's just reach out to God here. Jesus, we thank you for your love for us. That you would come and love us so much that you would come and die for us, die for our sins, to resurrect our lives. And because of that love, you chose to face the biggest challenge of humanity, Think about that. You embraced it so that you looked at it from your Father's perspective, so that we could have forgiveness, new life, and eternity with you. We look to you as not only our forgiver and our leader, but also our example today. From you, we learn that hard things can produce good things in our lives. We want to be people of integrity that grow through challenges. We want to face them with joy, knowing that you can use them for our good. Satan may mean them for evil. He might want to use them to destroy us, but you want to use it to prove us. We want to become more complete, more like you through each and every challenge, God, that we face. So Jesus, today I pray for all those who are hurting or experiencing trouble or loss or pain. I pray for every person who has a need, that they would surrender it into your capable hands. And if I could just kind of pause here and give some direction. If you have a need, a challenge that you're experiencing, whether it's spiritual, physical, emotional, relational, whatever it is, just lift up your hands right now. Yeah, just as an act of surrender. What does somebody do when they surrender? They put up their hands, right? As a gesture of releasing your situation into God's loving, capable hands, saying, hey, I'm going to look at this thing from your perspective, and I trust you. All right, let's continue. Jesus, we lift these needs before you, and we invite you to work in and through each and every one of them. We pray and believe for healing and for provision and for peace and for strength and for wisdom, God. We entrust these problems that we have before you, these challenges, these hurts to you, believing that you will guard our hearts and minds with your peace and make us stronger. And Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name, move in our hearts and lives today. Restore what the enemy has stolen. Give hope and help to the hurting. Give courage and strength to the weak. Fill our hearts with peace and joy regardless of our circumstances. Fill us with the Holy Spirit. Empower our lives to be a witness for you, even through difficulty or because of how we're facing difficulty. We want all that you have for us. Yeah, we want to be people of integrity. We want to represent you well on this earth with our words, our actions, in alignment with our faith in you. And so we trust you, we rest in you, we invite you to work in us and through us as we walk through troubled times and challenges on this earth. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Well, I hope God's using these words to challenge you. At this time, I would like to invite Pastor Sherry, my beautiful wife and companion, and who's just been with me. We really have done ministry together all these years. I couldn't do it without her. She makes me so much better. I'd like to invite her to come up front here today so that we can share a very important announcement with you. You know, this morning we've looked at into God's Word, and we've talked about being people of integrity, you know, walking our talk, embracing challenges by seeing them from God's point of view, His perspective, that challenges are an opportunity to evaluate, to grow, and be made complete in God. Well, Sherry and I believe that the Lord Jesus has been challenging us to take a new step of obedience in our lives. And we have been evaluating and growing and wrestling and trying to discern Jesus' perfect will for our lives for some time now. And we believe that the Lord has spoken, that He has revealed His will to us for our next chapter. So with that being said, we're going to read a letter here to you. But please know, we read this letter with love, humility, and most of all, gratefulness of heart. We are so grateful for everything God has done. Hello, church family and friends. We read in the book of Ecclesiastes, to everything there is a season, And this speaks of the different chapters in the book of our lives. We have always trusted that God is leading us, and we trust Him with the pages of our life story, and we believe that God is leading us to turn the page and begin a new chapter. We've been leading the church at Malpe for 33 years this fall, and welcomed our Monroe campus 8 years ago. It's been a long and amazing chapter, full of God's grace and goodness, to be sure. We are so thankful for the countless lives that have been transformed by Jesus, that are in heaven, that are in the kingdom, the many miracles we've seen, healings, restored marriages and families, freedom from addictions, and so much more. What a privilege to share in what God is doing.
We are so grateful that God called us to lead this incredible church family, and it is an honor to share life with you. Our words can't express how thankful we are for those who are and have been part of this chapter of our lives. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your support and your encouragement. Whether you've been with us for the long haul or for just a short season, we appreciate all of you and your willingness to come alongside us to share in God's great mission to rescue and restore humanity. There is no greater mission. We came to Malpe with a two-year-old and a newborn and welcomed two more children in those first few years. And our children were blessed to grow up in this church. And our greatest joy is seeing them love Jesus and serve Him well. Our kids and their spouses, Christina Michael Forey, David and Haley Brecky, Catherine Brecky, Andrew and Miyoko, they have all been our most faithful supporters. And their tireless and faithful service and leadership has been an integral part of our ministry at the church. And we can't thank them enough. Yeah. So today we share with you that God is leading us to a new chapter. We submitted a letter of resignation to the board of directors, and over the last year have been praying and working with them through the steps towards a healthy transition for the church. We know that God has a good and exciting new chapter for the church ahead. And we trust that God will further build and grow this church upon this strong foundation that's been laid.
So we will continue to serve as your lead pastors for 5 more months. So we'll be here leading with vision and even leading the Experience Israel trip in October, which we're so excited about. We will continue to serve with passion and integrity to ensure that this church, that's you, by the way, continues to thrive and stay focused on the mission of connecting all generations to Christ through loving, growing, and serving until November 1st, when your new lead pastor assumes leadership. We know that you will have questions, right? About us, about the church, about who will be the new pastor here. And those are all fantastic, good questions. And in due time, over the next few months, you'll learn more about the church's next chapter. But know that we are working hard with the board to ensure that the stability and mission of this amazing church continues. Know that we love you and we are privileged to lead you. And yes, our hearts are hurting at the thought of retiring from here and leaving you. But we trust that God is leading us to turn the page and bring this chapter of our life and ministry to a close as we begin a new one. We are confident that God will continue to use us for His purposes as we begin this new chapter. One by one, our children have been relocating, and we will join them in Montana, where we will be planting a church, Lord willing, and more on that later. For now, just mark your calendars and save the date, October 2nd, for a farewell event. Whether you're new to the church or have been here for many years, or if you've attended at some time over the last 33 years, we would love to have you join us to celebrate all that God has done. So, as we prepare to turn the page, we want you to know how blessed we are that you are written into the pages of our lives. You will always be part of our story. So thank you for allowing us to serve and lead you.
So we ask for your prayers, prayers for us and prayers for you, an incredible church family. We have a lot to process through personally as we prepare for our future. And as we walk the church, you, through this transition into your exciting next chapter, into your future, again, like he said, know that we love you all. And we look forward to the next 5 months of loving, growing, and serving alongside you. And we will be keeping you, the church will be keeping you updated throughout this whole process. Thank you.
God bless you. We love you.